We've been having a little bit of connection issues. Can you guys see my face? Can you hear this? Oh, good. I'm glad. I'm so happy. Well, thank you guys for being patient. And welcome to Lonely Together. Lonely Together is a conversation series where we just get to talk about life, talk a little bit about what inspires us, songwriting, with some interesting people. And I hope that it brings a little light to your day today. I'm in Nashville, Tennessee, and very happy because the sun is shining. Thank God. It's been cloudy a lot of days this week, and so the sun really is giving me life right now. So grateful. Also, this is so much fun. This is episode 2. On Tuesday, we did our first episode with Patrick Droney, and it was so much fun, and I hope you guys had a great time, and I hope that you've been able to buy all his music and listen to him and have him inspire you, because he's incredible. And today, I'm very, very excited. The special guest this afternoon is Miss Mary Steenburgen, and she's one of my favorite people on planet Earth. I met her about 4 years ago, and y'all may know Mary. She's an incredible actor in some of our favorite films in the world, right? We're also very grateful for her. But I know Mary as the songwriter, and so we're going to dive into her journey, and so I'm so excited to talk with her today. But first, before we invite her on, I do want to just start off by taking a deep breath. So if everybody wants to join me, you can close your eyes, in through the nose. That feels really good. One more time. Let it all out. Feels good to breathe. We're in day 14 of quarantine, and so we're finally getting a stride, and I've learned that breathing is gonna help us get through this whole thing. So I'm gonna invite Mary in on this convo. Let's see, here she is. Have a good time. We're waiting for Mary to join. Connecting. Hello!
Hi!
How are you doing, Mary?
I'm so good. I'm happy to see your beautiful face.
Same. You're in lovely LA, correct?
In lovely LA, and the sun is shining, and we are doing what we're all supposed to do, which is stay home for those that we love, for the planet, and certainly for people who are Ted's and my age. So we really are grateful to everybody who's making all the sacrifices that they are, especially, we were just speaking to friends this morning who are in New York, and two of the four of them have had it and had to quarantine themselves from the other two.
Yeah.
And people are going through tough stuff, and our hearts are full of love for everyone, for the planet, especially for Nashville, who just had gotten through.
Oh, I know.
Just the storm. So
yeah, the tornado, and then it just felt like this happened like pretty much right after. And so the world has been crazy. But we were talking just yesterday about how, you know, the tiny like kind of comfort is that we are all going through this together. Like, it's not just a small section of the world. It literally is the whole world kind of slowing down to try and protect people, right?
We were in Vietnam around this time last year, and we reached out to friends that we met in Vietnam, and that family of four is all hunkered down in their apartment. And when you speak to people so far away, it's really, it is hard to wrap your head around the scope of it, but it is huge. I will say music has been my lifesaver through this, and people are putting out such original and beautiful ways of making music. I watched the Rotterdam Philharmonic Orchestra do Beethoven's Ninth, and actually,
I just got chills.
It's the first time I've cried through this, and it was crying at the beauty of
absolutely
of human nature and the, you know, the power of music, and I'm so sorry that you put this beautiful supernova record out when you couldn't do your tour. You had to come back in from your tour, and when you couldn't go, I know you were going to go on the Today Show and probably the Tonight Show, which you've done before. And I'm so glad people are tuning in to this, and I encourage everyone to listen to Supernova. It's so special. It resonates so beautifully for this moment in time, because it really is not it's not about you know, trivial things. It's about the human heart and about loving deeply and missing people, and it feels like I've listened to it on repeat, and it's a really beautiful addition to this magical musical moment in time.
Wow, thank you so much, Mary. That's so kind of you to say. I'm grateful that it's out for the world, and it is strange, like all of our plans were kind of foiled by this, but the music is still out there, and it's, you know, in this time right now, is such a healer for people. Mm-hmm. To just kind of get out of their head, get out of the anxiety, and just be able to just kind of tune out. I've been hearing people like listening to it while they're cooking or just cuddling on the couch. It's such a blessing. So thank you for saying that. Yes. Well, I'm so grateful that you are taking the time to join me today we're being lonely together, Mary.
Lonely Together, which is one of the lovely songs on your beautiful record.
Thank you so much. But I wanted to like introduce my fam and friends to Mary, the songwriter. I mean, that's how we met. I was counting, it was like 4 years ago. And I wanted, you know, I wanted you to share your journey, like of becoming a songwriter. And so tell us about that, because it's pretty crazy, you guys.
It's pretty crazy. Well, for those of you who have already heard it, I apologize. I'll try to tell it succinctly, but it is a crazy story. I would say that I spent most of my life being a normal person in regards to music. I was not a musician. I didn't have any musical aspirations. I enjoyed music. The first concert I ever went to was the Beatles. The summer after fifth grade. And so, I've always appreciated music, but my focus was acting, and I love my work. I still do. And I love being an actor, and it just wasn't anything that ever occurred to me. April 17th, 2007, I had a surgery on my right arm. It was really not a big, huge deal, other than I did have to be put under general anesthetic. And so I came out, and my arm was fine, and my brain felt very different. And it felt, the best way I can describe it is that it went from a movie that was just normally scored to an overscored movie where there was no moment that there wasn't music. And everything everybody said kind of went into this musical tornado. And it wasn't fun or lovely. It was terrifying because all I wanted in the beginning was to just have my old brain back. Because if you think about it, the one thing we don't have to think about is what we sound like inside of our brain. It just is what it is since you were little.
Right.
So after weeks of not sleeping and trying to make sense of it and talking to some doctors and things like that, I finally kind of looked at myself in the mirror and said, it's not gonna stop. And you have four kids, you have a husband, you have a career, you have to get it together and figure this out. So I didn't really know where to even begin, but I started studying studying song structure and looking at the songs of the Beatles and lots of other great songwriters and just looking. I didn't know a verse from a chorus, truthfully. I had no clue how people wrote songs.
That's
and
amazing.
So I started with that, and I spent a summer just trying to study as much as I could learn about songwriting.
Yeah.
And then I started singing into a microphone what I would hear in my head and sculpting it a little bit into songs. And then there's a guy named Mike Benjamin, who's a wonderful singer-songwriter on Martha's Vineyard and very talented musician. And I said, if I sing what I hear in my head for you, will you sing the songs? And together we'll make music together somehow.
Right.
And so we did that. And I took my 12 favorite of those songs, and we sent it anonymously to a music lawyer that is a huge music lawyer in LA. I put my mother's name, Nellie Wall, on it.
I love it.
And so he called my manager, whose number was on there, and said, you know what? I want to work with this kid. And my manager goes, yeah, a kid might not describe her, but I will send her in. And so I went in, and we had this, I mean, he's like, Mary Steenburgen, what are you doing here? And I said, you already said you wanted to work with me and you don't want to be ageist, you know? So he's been my music lawyer since then. And he sent the music to Universal, who I worked with, and they sent me to Nashville. Nashville, I was so privileged to write with amazing songwriters like Troy Burgess, who has two of the songs on your record. Yes.
He's the best. The
and
best.
Barry, Barry Dean and
also Tracy the best.
Berg and, you know, just Lucy Silvas and John Osborne, and the list kept growing. And I now have so many musical partnerships that I treasure and that I love. And in these years, which now has been like 13 years, I've really grown. And what I think happened to me, honestly, is that I think I always had a musical component to my brain. Mm-hmm. But in your case, yours, you don't remember life without it. And somehow that surgery opened my musical component up. And it was overwhelming in the beginning, right. But now I'm gradually. So, you know, I think of myself as a modestly gifted 13-year-old musician who actually knows a lot about life. So
that's unbelievable.
Yeah.
It's amazing, Mary.
Yeah.
I love it so much.
There's a couple of things about it that are important for everybody. And that is that when you're young, everybody says, you can do it. You whatever your kids say to you, we all say, you can do it. Don't say you can't do it. Don't hold yourself back. You can do anything. And then there is some crazy age where nobody says that to you anymore. And it's like, why? You know, why does that need to be true? And so the one thing I take away from it is not that everybody should run out. but it is that you can do a lot more than you think you can, and that you should try saying yes instead of I can't do something. My answer to people when they say that is I say yet. I'm learning to play the piano. I took lessons as a kid, but I wasn't very good, and I still can't really read music, but I'm playing by ear and bizarrely.
You can play by ear or you need. What I love about that too is like we've all kind of been strangely gifted this time where we're staying home, where we're not, you know, where we don't really have much, you know, some of us are working from home, and but some of us might have some time on our hands where we can like dig in and like do that thing that you always wanted to learn. And so I want to encourage people tuning in, like, you know, think about that thing that maybe you always wanted to learn piano, or maybe you always wanted to try and write a song. Like, what a better time than now to try.
This is the moment. You have been handed a gift.
Yeah.
If you choose to see it that way.
Right.
Yeah. And it's not that easy for so many people during this time, because they're out saving the rest of us. And please know when we talk about such things, I always am holding them in my heart.
Absolutely.
But yes, it's good to remember that yes is sometimes the best thing to say.
I love that. What I also love about the story you shared is, you know, you woke up with all this music and in your head, and you didn't know what to do, how to organize it. And you decided to become like a student of songs. Like you started just researching. And that's something that, like, whenever anybody asks me like advice for new writers, or, you know, like, how do I start writing? Like, that's the first thing I say is like, start listening to the Beatles, like start listening to the best of the best and studying how it's done. How does the structure work? Like, how does this melody work? And like, just dig in and then try it and see what happens.
Right. And.
Oh, a little bit of cutting out. I don't know if you guys see that. There you are. Welcome back.
The other thing I would say is that part of the reason that, I mean, obviously I was more comfortable with the lyrical side of songs, and I've had to trust the melodies that I hear in my head. And when you and I write, you know, very often you're such a melodic genius that very often I'll, you know, well, you're kind of a genius in both, but anyway, I have to be brave sometimes to go, well, I hear this, you know, because I have so much faith in you. And so part of it is learning to trust what you hear, you know. And but a big part of it is, and I remember learning this many years ago about acting. I remember going to see many, many years ago, Lily Tomlin do a one-woman show in New York that was really one of the most brilliant pieces of theater anybody had ever seen. And I remember I was part of a comedy improv group at the time, and I remember having this instinct to do things inspired by her. Mm. And then I realized that her inspiration for me was not that I should try to emulate her. Her inspiration for me was that she had written that show from the very depths of her soul, and that she played multiple characters in it. And every single one of the characters, male and female, rang so true because they were all something that was true in her heart. And so that's the thing that I realized about songwriting is, well, A, I've been telling stories my whole life, you know, through acting, but these are stories that come from my life and from my heart and from my imagination in concert with whoever I'm writing with, or sometimes writing alone.
Right.
And so that thing about, you know, out of the truth in your heart come your songs. And that's probably more important now. I think great music will come from that. I did touch my face. I will wash my hands as soon as
it's hard. It's hard to not.
Don't write me. I'm aware I did that. And I will, I mean, this experience will be important for people to write about and to express their feelings about. And
absolutely.
Yeah.
One thing that I was finding while I was writing Supernova, and really like trying to do as a practice, was just become vulnerable, open up those stories that I've lived and like dig around in there. And what I find is in vulnerability, I find you get connection. Like people are able to like, even like the strangest details that you think only apply to your life, there's some strange way that people are able like to get that on a deep, deep level. And so
you did it. I mean, I felt you knowing you, but I think even people who aren't privileged like I am to know you will listen to Supernova and feel a connection both to you, but also to things that are so identifiable, you know.
Thanks, Mary.
You know, I don't want to love you anymore. That song, you're in my blood, you're in my veins, but my heart can't hear me when I say that I don't want to love you anymore. and everybody's been through that of a moment where they wish they could, boom, put the hammer down. But that's
right.
not how the human heart works, you know?
Exactly. Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
Well, I want to talk about some songs. I want to go back to the very first song that we wrote together, because I think it's just such a fun story.
We wrote two songs that day, by the way.
Two songs.
And I
know.
Both.
So special. Yeah. Both of them are magical.
Yeah.
But I touched my face too. What is wrong with me? So the first song that we wrote was called I Love You More. And I remember meeting you, and I remember you came in with this idea, and the first line out of your mouth was like, I don't know what this is, but I love you more than all the commas in all of the books. And I was like,
And I know exactly why. I was trying to express to my granddaughters how massive, how huge, how gargantuan my love for them is.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to cry. You're going to cry.
Yeah.
We're just going to start crying.
I'm missing them.
Oh,
but
totally.
Anyway, in trying to find a word big enough, I couldn't, you know, and Googleplex is not the world's most beautiful, you know, lyric.
Right.
And so I started thinking, what if I tell them I love you more than lots and lots of tiny things, like so many tiny things. And then looking at a book, and I started looking just on one page how many commas there were. So what if I love you more than all of the commas in all of the books, more than all the drops it took to fill the ocean up. I love you more than all the gardening.
The grapes in France.
I love more than all the grapes in France.
It was such a fun song to write. And I mean, the beautiful thing is I remember you sharing that about your grandkids. And like secretly, I had just found out I was pregnant with my first. I was like 6 weeks pregnant. And Troy Verges, who we were also writing with, also had just found out that they were pregnant, but we hadn't told each other. So we sat and wrote this kind of children's song, like love song. You're writing to your grandkids, and Troy and I are writing to like our secret babies.
Thomas and Lozy Pearl. Yes.
Thomas and Lozy Pearl, exactly. Yeah. And it's just such a special moment, and I love that song. And
we're going to find something. We were talking about this yesterday together, and we'll loop wonderful Troy in, and we'll find something really wonderful to do with this song maybe soon. Absolutely. Because it's such a special song, and it poured out of us and was a delight, a joy to write. And then we wrote.
I love it. I think Charlie, your kid, I think Charlie wants you to say hi.
What?
Charlie, he really wants you to say hi to him.
Is Charlie and Dal down there? Wait a minute.
Yeah, he really wants you to say hi.
Oh, hi, Charlie. I love that.
I've been dying over time.
Oh, my God.
It's so funny. I love it so much. There's a couple other songs that I want to talk about, but maybe before, let's see, I want to talk about what you and me and Troy have been doing for this fun new animated film. It's something I've never done before.
I haven't either.
Which is writing the music.
I want to do it forever now because it's so much fun.
I know. So, well, I mean, we've spent the last couple of years on writing songs for this, and so we're... So Mary and I and Troy Verges are working on the music for an animated film. It's all my Disney dreams coming true. Living my Disney kid life. So,
The producers of it are the same people that did Shrek and the Shrek series and Cloudy with Meatballs and Prince of Egypt. And they're all woman team of brilliant people. You and Troy and I and Lizzie McAvoy's also collaborated with me for one song on it, which is beautiful.
Yeah.
So
beautiful.
It's all based on the book The Underneath, which I'm sure a lot of people are familiar with. It's set in the East Texas bayous, and it's been really fun because you and I have been able, most of the characters are animals, and they're sweet animals, but there's also monsters, and so we've been able to get inside the head of a giant 100-foot-long, 1,000-year-old alligator, and a giant snake, and a sweet kittens, and all kinds of characters that that populate this magical Bayou Tartine. And it's just I have a greenhouse, and we sit in the greenhouse and channel animal voices.
And it's so much fun. It's totally different than writing for it's totally different than writing for a record or writing for an artist. Writing for film for specific scenes, you have to move the plot along, you have to get inside the character's head. Maybe talk about that a little bit, about how it's different.
Well, it's kind of, for me, it's this joyous combination of what I've done my whole life, which is you take words on a page and you think of how to make that character live and breathe And you say those lines over and over and over because that's how films and TV are shot. But every single time you say it, it has to be occurring to you for the first time. That's part of the, you know, the beautiful challenge and artistry of it. And you know, to now take that same thing about, well, with characters very often, like, obviously, I've only played women or girls and women as I've grown older in my career. And sometimes I ask myself, what's in their bag, their purse, their pocketbook, what's in there, you know, that makes them who they are. And, you know, it can be anything from a very vain character who's just got a ton of makeup to a character that I played in Justified who literally pulled, no, she didn't pull the gun out of her purse. She shot a man through her purse.
That's amazing.
Because there was a gun in there. And, you know, so in writing for animated films, my God, you can get in the mind of, I can see my glasses are reflecting so much light. you can get in the mind of characters that are animals, and you can imagine what they're saying, and you can, and that's, to me, such a wonderful, luxurious challenge, is to go that to that crazy place in your imagination. That's just been such a joy. And then also to write with you this year or a couple of years ago, and with Kate York, to write for a movie that ended up being the song Glasgow, ended up being like a crazy journey.
Is the next song that I want to talk about. And I mean, it's a similar thing where you were able to get a copy of the script and they needed a song for the specific scene. And so, you know, we've got to read through what the story is and just get in this girl's head. And it's like, no pressure. This is just the culmination of everything that just happened in the film. Write it.
Yeah.
But it was so much fun to write because you just get inside somebody else's head and think, what are they going to say? And it ended up being a trip that we got to go on that was so much fun, with the song getting nominated for, won a Critics' Choice Award and was on the Oscars shortlist, which was
We won the Critics' Choice Award, but at the same time, we tied with Elton.
We tied with Elton John,
which was like, to me, better than just outright winning.
If you're gonna tie with someone, it better be Elton John.
Otherwise, yeah, exactly. Exactly. That changes it into being just a great big fat honor, you know.
Oh, it's so crazy! I know, it's the best.
Yeah. If people wanna see that song in the context of the movie's called Wild Rose, and Jesse Buckley gives a breathtakingly great performance as
I cried like a baby.
She's amazing
in that movie.
This is a good time to watch this movie. She is brilliant in it. She's actually, in real life, she's Irish, but in Wild Rose, she plays a Scottish young woman who she's trouble with a capital T. When you first meet her, she's just getting out of prison, and she's really kind of stepped all over her mother and her children to go after her dream of going to Nashville and making it in country music. And there, evidently, I didn't know this before we wrote this song and got all into it, but in Glasgow, there really is a kind of country music scene there, and a sort of Grand Ole Opry in Glasgow, which we need to go to together someday, because I'm constantly hearing from boats there that
I've never been, and it's just silly.
I've spent very, very little time there, but one of my best friends is from there, and so we called her that day. I remember the day we wrote it. It was raining, and it started out with me riding with Kate York that day, and we kind of started the song a little bit, and then you came, and we just ended up, you know, really, again, that song poured out, and it was, it, I think all of this knew what it felt like to leave people we love in search of a dream that was burning in us, and that that constant thing of, like, you know, how selfish should you be in life for your dreams, you know? And when I've thought about this a lot, and please, Charlie McDowell, my son, don't weigh in on this. Or do. I have no control over him. But, you know, I've tried to find the balance in life of being the best mom I could be, but also honoring, you know, Mary Nell Steenburgen from North Little Rock, Arkansas's big dreams, you know, and it's that constant kind of thing that we constantly try to figure out. And I know you've got two beautiful little boys, and I know you're constantly doing the same thing, you know. Right. So this is a story that to a great degree is about that. And it's about music and country music, three chords in the truth. And anyway, any chance that you're going to play it?
I'm going to play it.
Yes!
I'm so proud of this song. And I mean, like you were saying, it's for anybody that has that dream and is learning how to figure out how to get there. But the truth is that you learn so much about yourself. But it's about the journey, right? It's about the journey.
Yeah.
I've worn out the stones in front of the doors. Coming and going, coming and going. You left the lights on. I should have said thank you 1,000 miles ago, but I pushed you away, put a pin in the map, and then I got lost in the storm. Had to find my own way, make my own. You knew it, I had to go. In the yellow brick road, running through glass bowl, but I found one that's stronger than stone. Oh, ain't no. Over my window, shoebox of dreams hid under my bed. Follow the bright lights, city of gold. I had to leave to realize all I needed was you. Mama, we both know that there's nothing. Little time and Patsy Cline. Had to find my own way, make my own mistakes. click my heels 3 more times and there it all is. What's always been mine. Ain't no yellow brick road running through Glasgow, but I found one that's stronger than
I think there's lots of people applauding, so
thank you. Them.
And by the way, it's you know, it's a moment where we're cherishing home, so or being driven crazy by it, or missing it, or whatever. So it's kind of a perfect song for this.
I love that, Mary.
Yeah,
man. I mean. And for those of you who, I mean, if you dig that song, awesome, go listen to it. There is a video out there of Jesse singing it at Royal Albert Hall that will just blow your mind.
I'm pretty sure that blew their minds. But yes,
yeah. but she's so fun.
She's magnificent. Like, and she's honestly, so when we did that, when we wrote it and we recorded the demo on your computer, minutes after we finished the song, and we sent it off, and then we waited a little bit, and while we were waiting to hear if they were going to choose it, because there were lots of songs submitted for that movie, I thought, oh man, somebody less talented than Caitlyn maybe should have sung the demo, because I don't know who's going to play a part. But at that point, Jesse wasn't even cast. And I'm like, right. But whoever it is, they're not going to be able to sing like Caitlyn. And then they sent us, after she was cast, a rehearsal of her singing it. And she is as beautiful as you are. Kind of my, I mean, when you write with Caitlyn Smith, honestly, you just make up crap for her to just to hear the sound of her voice.
You're so
sweet. It's pretty incredible.
It's so fun. Well, it was so fun to write that with you and to go on that really fun wild ride and get this close to an Oscar nom.
Yes.
Next time. It was so fun. So if you guys are looking for something to do, check out Wild Rose and watch it tonight. But I do want to talk about Zoe's extraordinary playlist. Mary, I've been binge watching it right now, and it is so good, and it is exactly what I need in my life right now, so thank you. Tell me about the show, and tell people about the show who maybe haven't seen it yet.
Well, it'll sound a little bit familiar after the story I just told you about my own musical journey.
Totally.
There are some parallels, and not literally the same, but I was told that NBC had asked me to do a show called Zoe's Extraordinary Playlist, and I really didn't know very much about it except that it had a musical component to it. And then I read the script, and it's about a character named Zoe, and she lives in San Francisco, and her father is dying of a disease called PSP that is kind of related to Parkinson's disease. And it's similar to what my own mother died from. And it's hard, and it's hard on caregivers, and it's hard on the family. And it's especially, of course, hard for that person. And it happened to us. Yeah. Austin Winsberg, who created the show, his father passed away of this. And Austin is a very musical person and wanted to take the pain of that and somehow transform it into something beautiful. And So he created this show where Zoe, who's worried, I'll just tell you this without a spoiler thing, because it happens in the first few minutes of the first episode, but she's worried that she might have what her dad has. And I encourage her to go get an MRI. And she goes to get an MRI, and we live in San Francisco. And while she's in there, she's very, she's a very computer nerdy brain, not into music, not into art of any kind. And I think it's Michael Stipe singing "It's the End of the World as We Know It." And she, there was an earthquake. And so something crazy happens. And from that moment on, she hears people's heart songs. So this is not what happened to me exactly. But she looks at people, and maybe they're the coolest guy at work and the happy-go-lucky, you know, really sexy, adorable guy. But she can hear that inside he's singing "Mad World." And the choreographer, because she sees these as song and dance.
It's
moments.
So beautiful.
Yeah.
I can't get over the choreography. It's stunning.
She's one of the many reasons we're all there. And her name is Mandy Moore. It's not the same beautiful Mandy Moore who is a singer and a wonderful actor. This is the woman who did the choreography for La La Land. And she's worked on Dancing with the Stars and many other dance-related things. And she's just, what's so brilliant about what she does is that for those of us who are totally haven't done anything like this before, the dance is really about expressing what's in your soul and your heart, and yeah, not necessarily about suddenly it's a dance routine. It's really movement that expresses what's happening in your heart. And the first question I asked when I sat down with them is, do you guys know my story? And they sort of looked at each other and laughed. And so I said, but the thing is, you know, I write music. I'm not especially confident at all as a singer. And they said, well, we've heard you sing and it's fine. You should do this, you know? And so I, again, said yes to something that scared the living daylights out of me. Oh my gosh, I'm so not in my comfort zone. And yet I can bring the acting to these moments, because that's how I've learned to express myself. And so I'm learning to just marry it all together. And it's just got such an extraordinary cast, you know, led by Jane Levy, who plays Zoe, who's brilliant in it. And, but Skylar Astin and Lauren Graham and Alex Newell and my friend Andrew Leeds and Peter Gallagher plays my husband, and Kapil Talwalkar. There's so many beautiful actors in this thing, and it's very ambitious. It's really hard to film essentially a musical it was 8 days, right? And it comes on Sunday nights on NBC, but you can also catch up on it on I think Hulu and YouTube. Mm-hmm. A lot of people have watched it on that, and it's funny and it's moving, and I think it's,
I've
kind
cried
of,
multiple times. It's,
yeah,
wonderful.
It's really kind of a beautiful, brave, ambitious, exciting thing.
I love it. It's so wonderful. And like I said, if you guys are looking for something to binge watch right now, please go binge watch it. You will not regret it, because it's amazing. And you do incredible. I saw your scene where you're singing, and it's so real and raw, and just, it's effing awesome.
So, thank you.
Great job, Mary. Well,
thank you.
I want to thank you so much for joining me. And thank you guys for tuning in too. I hope that this gave you guys a little light today, a little inspiration, help pass a little bit of the time.
And I want to say, supernova, a supernova, I thought, I don't actually know what that means. So I looked it up and it's a powerful, luminous, stellar explosion. Yes. But I think this is the luminous explosion. That's you and your heart and your talent, which is so big. And I don't think they're accidents. I think this is coming out in the way it's coming out, probably perfectly and probably at the right moment, because you know, there's so many things in here that will just take people away and connect to their hearts. And so perhaps it wouldn't have been the same if it came out at a more perfect time. So I'm so proud of you and of all the songwriters who wrote on this beautiful, beautiful record. And I can't wait for us to get together
I know.
Write. Yeah, I think maybe my favorite thing I've written is a song called Talking to Trees, which if you're gonna figure out the language of trees, you want to do it with Troy Burgess and Caitlyn Smith.
Absolutely. Thank you, Mary. Well, I hope that you guys have a beautiful rest of your day, and give a big hug to Ted for me, please. Stay safe, please. And to all of you guys tuning in, I'm going to be here next Tuesday, same time, 2 p.m. Central. We'll be talking with Cam, who is one of my favorite artists out there. She's so magical. Brand new mama.
Yes.
Do you love her? She's magic.
Oh, she's lovely, and her baby is so adorable.
Oh, I can't even deal with how... What kills me is, like, that this all happened like right after she had her baby. I haven't gotten to hold her baby yet. I'm so jealous. I just want to snuggle that tiny little human in time.
Don't get me started again, Caitlyn.